Yeah, awesome, great. And a bit more about my background too. So for almost 2 decades, I was doing AI, some of it machine creativity, some of it for AI to drive Moore's Law, a lot of genetic programming. So I was quite in that community, which of course very deep ties to the complex systems community. And then more recently, about 5 years ago, I started getting into blockchain because I saw just kind of the amazing cool things that you could do with it. And I've been immersed in those ever since. And in the last year, I've started to really dive into the interactions between AI and blockchain, and there are numerous interactions. You'll get a flavor of some of this today. So, without further ado, just get going. So this talk, I realized that what I wanted to do for this talk was to kind of give you guys a flavor of some of the things out there on sort of the intersections between complex systems and blockchain technology. And it's kind of surprising that there are many. And kind of how I arrived at this was about a year and a half ago, I started asking myself the question of how do AI and blockchain technologies interact? And I had some initial ideas, and I explored this. And so when I was first thinking, leading up to talking with David and towards this talk, I took those ideas from AI and I generalized them to other complex systems thinkings. So I'm going to talk about blockchains as trust machines. This is the sort of thing you would have read in The Economist a couple of years ago. But also blockchains as incentive machines, getting people to do stuff, and what that looks like, economics. And then EDA design for token design. So it turns out that experiences in the world of evolutionary algorithms can be very, very useful for token design, as well as agent-based simulation has direct application. Then I'm going to talk about what I like to call benevolent computer viruses, aka smart contracts, which is basically decentralized processing running on things like Ethereum. AI DAOs, which are basically AIs that are agents, like AGI-type agents, running around on decentralized substrate that basically own themselves. And those are just radically interesting on their own. And finally, sort of culminating to be talking about blockchains as life, riffing on some of Ralph Merkel's ideas there. So I'll get started. So blockchains as trust machines. And by the way, this part is probably, it starts off looking mundane, but it quickly gets more and more interesting. So bear with me for the next few slides. Well, I guess this isn't that boring. This is a picture from Reddit or 4chan or something about magic internet money, Bitcoin, of course. And Bitcoin, the paper was published in 2008, so 10 years ago. And the network appeared in 2009 from, you know, as you probably all know, a pseudonymous person or team named Satoshi Nakamoto. And at first, it was just, you know, this cool sort of weird little corner thing among a bunch of cypherpunks. But bit by bit, it gathered more and more steam towards now, it's a $200 billion ecosystem. And it has sparked this sort of blockchain revolution where the total value of that ecosystem of all these different blockchains is $500 billion to $1 trillion, depending on the hour. So there's a lot of volatility in these things. But basically, Bitcoin was kind of amazing because the very first time in the world we had a money or a store of value, a currency that was not owned or controlled by anyone. People had dreamed about this for years and years and years, and even tried things. You know, back in the late 90s, there was something called DigiCash that tried to do electronic money. But it had a challenge, and that was it was centrally distributed, centrally controlled, and part of the control was via the banks. So when the banks started realizing that this was kind of a threat to their power, they essentially shut it down, right? Well, along came Bitcoin, right on the heels of the financial crash, and motivated by that, and said, hey, you know, let's do something where it can be this currency or token of value that is independent of any governments, independent of any borders, independent of the banks, and be useful to humanity. And well, it's made a huge difference. And the main thing is as a spark to the rest of it. So, you know, what's underlying Bitcoin is this thing called blockchain. And you can think of blockchain as a technology or as a field. And I like to think of it mostly as a field, just like AI is a field or complex systems. It's not just one technology. It's a collection of technologies and ideas, questions, research questions. And that's the healthiest. There are huge debates. You know, just like, you know, going back every decade, there's huge debates about what is AI, right? Well, there's also debates that rage about what is blockchain. And it's really not that healthy. Just think of it as a field, know that people are going to argue over it, and move on. But one way to think about blockchains, simply a mundane way, is it's Google Sheets without the Google, right? So what is Google Sheets? You go on there, and you can make entries to the ledger, this list of things, values, transactions. And you can share that with others, and those other people can make changes too, right? Of course, that is all running on Google compute infrastructure, therefore centrally controlled by Google. What if you can actually remove the central control? So you've got this ledger, this spreadsheet that's out there that no single entity is owning or controlling. And instead, it's this public utility for the planet, not unlike electricity or air, right? So that's a good way of thinking about it. And there's a couple other interesting characteristics. Once you've written a new row to that spreadsheet, it's there for good. It doesn't change, right? Let's see here, it's actually, I'll go look at this. And then, so each row you can think of as a transaction. So you can, there's two types of transactions. There's issuing a currency or a token, claiming copyright on a piece of art, whatever you want. And then there's transferring the ownership of that or the control of that from person A to person B. So that's really the main things. So Google Sheets without the Google with these, you know, extra characteristics. Now, of course, a spreadsheet is sort of a very specific version of something more broad, which is databases, right? And databases are essentially spreadsheets with querying, right? And they tend to have better scalability properties and so on, right? So think like MongoDB or MySQL or whatever, right? So you can think also of blockchains, therefore, as simply databases, but they've got three new characteristics compared to traditional databases. So, you know, the baseline of traditional databases, you've got, they're storing this list of transactions, and you can query on them, and they even are distributed. So there's a big distinction between the word distributed and decentralized. So there's sort of, call it three levels. They're centralized in terms of control, in terms of compute resources, you know, like an Oracle database. It's one box, right? And then you can have centralized control, but you can spread resources among many machines, right? So it feels like one machine, but it's actually many machines. So like, you know, MongoDB or whatever. And that's distributed, and distributed systems have been around decades. This is what powers the web, right? You know, Google has thousands, hundreds of thousands, millions of machines to be storing data, et cetera, right? Google, Facebook, et cetera. And this is where we have things like MongoDB, et cetera. So that's distributed. But distributed still has just one sysadmin, right? So one person can go in there and pull the plug, right? So if Jeff Bezos doesn't like you, he can, you know, kick you out of Amazon, right? If he wanted, right? So whereas the next level, so you have centralized in terms of control and resources, then you have distributed, where you've got one sysadmin, but a spread of resources on many machines. But the next thing you can do is not only spread resources on many machines, you can spread control on many machines. And this is decentralized. So it's this idea of spreading out control, or think of it like many sysadmins. Instead of one sysadmin, you have 10 or 100 or 10,000. And so that's decentralized, and you can even go one level further and say, you know what? You don't even need permission to be a sysadmin. Anyone can join in and just help run a node. And that's called permissionless decentralized. And that's what public blockchains are. Question? Yeah, so that's a great question. And traditional blockchains, you know, from Bitcoin and a lot of them are not really designed for scale at all, right? In fact, you know, they're really just a list of transactions, and the only real way to query them is through things called blockchain explorers, where it's basically a web page that goes in and you type in something on the top and it searches through sort of in a linear fashion, has to look at every transaction, right? But that's a constraining view of blockchains. You don't need to think of it that way. You can think of it as something a bit more generalized, where you can query anything inside. You can actually be storing, you know, not just lists, but you can have JSON documents, et cetera. And in fact, this is kind of the view that we took in building BigchainDB. So we were actually building an application on top of Bitcoin back in 2013, back when no one thought it was cool at all, right? And anything, and people were mad at us because we were putting dust on top of the Bitcoin blockchain. Oh my God, it's not Bitcoin. We're actually trying to do art and stuff on top. So we said, you know what? We ran into these issues of scale, but why is it that, you know, traditional blockchains like Bitcoin scale so badly. And one of the reasons is, well, they didn't optimize for it, for starters. They optimized for sort of social scalability, this idea of really not having to trust anyone at all, right? And you know, and being permissionless where anyone can join. And really, Bitcoin is, its idea of identity is one electron, one vote. So it's sort of like a perfect democracy for electrons, right? Where it's basically doing this proof of work algorithm to do consensus. I won't get into that, but that's what Bitcoin was about. Now, but you can generalize this idea saying, what if we actually dialed back a little bit on the sort of social scalability and said, it's okay to know the identities of people running the nodes, where you can actually have sort of a list of who's running, but then make it where, you know, if you have, say, 20 sysadmins or 100 sysadmins, if a few of them act badly, you're still okay, right? And then give it other blockchain characteristics, which is immutable in assets. So the decentralized is really, you know, many sysadmins where some can attack, you're okay. And then immutable is once you've written to it, it's like it's there for good. And then assets, it's this idea that when you put a transaction there, you're signing it with this digital signature so that people can cryptographically prove that it was you. And when you do these transactions, you can, you know, issue assets, transfer them. And the decentralized really is this idea of, it's in the literature, it's called Byzantine fault tolerance. It goes back to research out of Microsoft in the early 80s, Leslie Lamport and so on. And it's really this idea that you've got, there's sort of three, I'll just say two levels of tolerance. There's crash fault tolerance, where we, in like MongoDB and all this, if I've got, you know, 50 nodes running, if one node goes down and its hard drive goes down, it's okay because we have backups of that data in other nodes. Maybe we've got three backups, five backups, right? That's like a replication factor of three or five. But if one of the nodes actually plays the role of sysadmin and attacks the rest of the system, everything goes down, gets wiped out. That's fault tolerant. But you can also be Byzantine fault tolerant, where if a sysadmin goes rogue, or even a few, you're okay. So they can attack the rest of the network and you're still gonna be okay. So fault tolerant is crash faults, and then Byzantine faults is malicious nodes. And you can go kind of one level up to be civil tolerant, where this is sort of the permissionless game, where people can join all they want. So with Big Chain, when we ran into this issue with Ascribe, which was an application on Bitcoin, we said, let's build our own blockchain technology. We said, you know, databases scale like crazy. There's great distributed database technology out there, like MongoDB and CouchDB and all these. They're powering the web, right? So let's start with one of those. We started with Mongo, and then wrap it to make it, to give these other interesting new characteristics, right? And it's those three ones that I talked about, decentralized immutable assets. So that's actually what we've been building for the last number of years now, BigChainDB. And it's open source software. You can download and play with it. People are building applications on it, right? That's where it really relates to database technology, because you've got querying, you've got the scale that you expect from a database, but then it's got these interesting blockchain characteristics too. So this is just sort of the baseline of like blockchains as sort of an extension of databases, right? And I guess another key thing here, people like to call them trust machines, because it minimizes the trust needed to use them to deploy, right? So if there's 100 sysadmins collectively running this database, I don't need to trust each sysadmin, I only need to collectively trust the group, right? Or for like the Bitcoin blockchain, I don't need to trust each of the individual people running a node, you know, each of those sysadmins, I only need to trust the group overall, right? And that's much different than, you know, right now, if you're using a bank, you need to trust the bank, and you need to trust very particular employees in the bank, like the sysadmin, et cetera, not to take your money, right? Now, of course, you have insurance, but you have to trust the government to not screw up as well there, right? And so on. So that's blockchains as trust machines, but they can get much more interesting than that. So not just sort of this fancy database, but going one level beyond. And that's blockchains as incentive machines. And so, you know, I talked about decentralized immutability assets as really interesting new characteristics of blockchains above and beyond simply databases. But there's one more, and this one more I've come to realize, especially the last year or two, it's really a superpower. And what is it? You can get people to do stuff. How do you get them to do stuff? By giving them block rewards, by giving them tokens. How do you give them tokens? Magic internet money, right? So this blockchain that's out there, whether it be Bitcoin or Ethereum or whatever, a public blockchain, it's printing money every now and then. It's issuing tokens. And it's giving those tokens to people to do whatever it wants them to do, right? And I'll give some examples, right? But this is just a takeaway to start with. It's just blockchains, public blockchains, are a means to get people to do stuff. Wildly powerful idea. So so with Bitcoin, for example, what Bitcoin is trying to do is maximize its security. It says, I want to be the most secure transaction banking financial system in the world, right? How does it do that? It defines security as difficulty of undo a transaction. So it's sort of like you have a list of transactions, and then it wraps that list with another list of transactions on top, and then another and another and another in sort of this linked list type fashion, or a blockchain. And a blockchain in the narrow technical sense is simply a linked list of blocks, where a block is simply a group of transactions. And that the links are hashed, so a hash is a previous block. But it really works like rings on a tree, or like a shell that grows bigger and bigger and bigger. But how this manifests for Bitcoin simply then is, as time goes on, it's growing thicker and thicker and thicker, longer and longer and longer as a chain, and it makes it harder and harder and harder to undo transactions. And what it's doing then is saying, given that it's trying to maximize security, it defines security as the amount of computational effort to unroll this chain, to undo the transactions. And then it says to undo those transactions, you need to do hashing, which comes down to spending electricity. So basically, it's essentially, its objective function is to maximize security. In practical terms, this means maximizing electricity. Interesting, right? And people, sorry? Yeah. You can undo it if you actually, I'm not sure if I have slides. I don't have slides on that. So overall, you've got this linked list of blocks. So block one followed by block two, block three, block four. And block one has, say, 1,000 transactions. And then when block two gets formed, whoever forms block two, they form it by spending lots and lots of compute effort. And block two actually has the hash of block one. It's this cryptographic hash. Think of it like a digital fingerprint. And then block three comes along, and it has the hash of block two, and so on and so forth. But in order to get the right to create that block, you need to spend basically a ton of compute power, on average more than anyone else, right? And so you've got one block, two block, three block, four block, five block, and you might say, okay, you know, block five, is there a way to undo block five? Well, there's a bunch of people competing at once to create a block, right? And they're all spending lots of electricity doing mining, right? And each of them have big, huge data centers like this these days running custom ASICs, right? That's where it's gone to. And it's sort of like, it's like roulette wheel selection. It's proportional to your compute power, your hash power. You can you can get a block or not. And so whoever gets lucky in throwing that dice, they get a block or not. And then that's the new block, block five, and then block six. So but let's say that you've got, you know, block five that gets formed, and someone else starts mining block six, but then someone else decides to try to mine block five again. They could, and Bitcoin has this key thing called the longest chain rule. So the most valid chain is the longest chain, right? So if I come along and mine block five again, and then block six and block seven quietly, and so then you actually have sort of two chains going at once. And then I announce to the network that I've done block seven, it wipes away the previous blocks from before. So I can unroll the network if I actually quietly have more compute power than anyone and come up with a longer chain. And there's a very practical ramification for this. Sort of the nightmare scenario would be, it turns out most of the hashing power is in China these days, largely because China subsidizes the electricity. And so they've got like 95% of the hash power. If China put up its own sort of firewall for the internet, or even just Bitcoin for, say, a month, then there would be a fork in the Bitcoin blockchain. There would be two chains going along. There would be the Chinese chain and the non-Chinese chain. And they'd be going along. People would be putting transaction to each side. But then if China took away that firewall and the chains merged, the longest chain would win. And because China has more hash power, all the transactions in the non-China chain would go away, right? So there's no concept of finality in the traditional database sense. It's really just the sort of probabilistic thing of the longest chain, right? Now, of course, in order to unroll it, you have to spend tons and tons of compute power. So it makes this security assumption that longest chain is kind of good enough, and it's just super expensive to unroll, right? But this is kind of the cool thing too. It basically, Bitcoin is saying, maximize the security by maximizing electricity usage, right? And so they're sort of going towards this, you know, getting people to do stuff by rewarding with tokens. Once again, Bitcoin is saying, I'm getting you to maximize security by spending crap loads of electricity, and I'm going to reward you with Bitcoin for doing that. So. Well, even unrolling just that last block is, of course, the same cost as doing the next one. So doing the last, say, months of blocks, it's basically been exponential growth, by the way, in terms of hash rate, right? Like the electricity used and so on. So it's sort of like the last few months is the most dominant compared to the 10-year lifetime of Bitcoin, right? And it's basically, to give you a feel, there's more compute power in the flops of this than all the supercomputers of the world combined, right? You couldn't really unroll unless you, it would have to go backwards and recreate chains going on. It would have to create its own new blocks going way, way back, right? And then mine things at the equivalent level of difficulty going forward. So you'd have to spend, it's not inconceivable, but the cost would be, these days, let's see, to do a miner, you basically can calculate quite quickly. Every 10 minutes, 12.5 Bitcoins get printed, right? A Bitcoin is worth about 10 grand. So therefore, about $100,000 worth of Bitcoin is printed every 10 minutes, right? And so basically, multiply that by a little bit, and whatever the number is per day, my brain is freezing, but let's say for fun, I don't know, $2 million, right? So then you go back for, say, a month, you're looking at $60 million just for breaking even. And for a year, then it's about basically $600 billion. But that's not a huge amount of money, right? You know, you spend $1 billion, $10 billion, you could do it, right? But of course, if you do this, then you're going to also destroy the price of Bitcoin. And it kind of destroys the mining, but you can undo. But Bitcoin is basically making the security assumption that people aren't going to do that, right? Question.
In practice, that the blocks are getting exponentially harder, but if you wanted to re-roll and create a whole bunch of blocks really fast, it would be much more difficult for you to do that. So it's not true that like rewinding the first 50 blocks is completely trivial now.
Yeah.
Because of this self-adjusting protocol.
Yeah. To rewind the first 50, you have to go back all the way, right? So, yeah. Question. Yeah, so these things are orthogonal. So basically, with each, it's a linked list of blocks, right? And each block has a bunch of transactions. And each transaction is, that's where the private keys are for myself, right? Yeah, it's within the block. Yeah, yeah, so. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So I'm gonna just keep going here. So now I'll talk about this more, but you can think about, you know, this, the thing that you wanted to do, you can view it as an objective function. And in the case of Bitcoin, it's trying to maximize security of the network, where security is compute power. And the rewards, so on the left there, it's expected block rewards are proportional to the hash power of that actor times the tokens dispensed in each block. So every 10 minutes, Bitcoin has sort of a schedule for how many tokens to dispense, right? I'll get into that. So basically, what this means is if I have 50% of the hash rate of the total Bitcoin network, then I have a 50% chance every 10 minutes to get those 12.5 Bitcoins, right? It's not proportional, so it's not like I get 12.5 times 0.5 Bitcoins every 10 minutes. It's roulette wheel, right, like that. So, and it does this because otherwise, let's say there's 1,000 people mining, then if it gave completely directly proportional to the mining power, it would have to do 1,000 transactions. And these days, there's about 5,000 miners out there, but only there's like five that comprise the majority of the mining, right? So this release schedule is it's exponential over time. So it's got a half-life of 4 years. So Bitcoin started mining in 2009. And then so in 2013, there was a halving. And then there was another halving last year, right? So that means that already more than 75% of the total Bitcoins that will ever come have been mined. But basically, it's going to take another 100 years or so for all of them to get mined, right? But of course, that last little bit, it's going to be pretty fractional. So that's basically the release schedule. And so any given point in time, there's, you know, you just integrate for that time slice of 10 minutes, and that's where you get this T here, right? The number of tokens dispensed in that 10 minutes, right? So like I mentioned, right now there's 12.5 bitcoins dispensed every 10 minutes. A couple years ago, there was 25. A couple years before, or a few years before that, there was 50, right? So, and like I've mentioned, you know, Bitcoin has succeeded remarkably well at this, right? In terms of getting people to do stuff, in terms of getting them to maximize security. In fact, by next year, by mid-next year, it's going to use more power than all of USA, right? It surpassed Iceland a couple years ago and so on. But by mid-next year, it's going to use more power than all of USA. And it's really kind of fascinating. You know, Elon Musk has talked about this paperclip generating AI, right? Where you, because AIs are kind of dumb and naive, all they do is go for their objective function, right? Which is, you know, if an AI is just trying to maximize the creation of paperclips, then you could have this paperclip creating monstrosity that just eats the world with paperclips. Well, we actually have an energy using monstrosity that is actually sucking up all the energy of the world. It's called Bitcoin, right? So this paperclip machine is actually happening, right? And it's kind of remarkable, right? Bitcoin is very, very cool in many ways, but it also just shows the sheer power of this thing. And it's not even an AI. It's pretty dumb, right? But it is, as I will talk about later, can be framed as a life form. So you've got this, you know, well, this life form sucking up the energy of the planet. Now, I mentioned this isn't just about Bitcoin, right? There's other blockchains out there doing lots of different things. Bitcoin is really about a store of value or a unit of exchange. Ethereum, I'll talk more about it later, is for decentralized processing. There's other things for decentralized file storage, like Filecoin, and many, many other things, right? Prediction markets, lots and lots of applications out there, right? And one of the things that we're working on now, we built BigchainDB. It doesn't have tokens, by the way. That's sort of like the blockchain 1.0. But sort of blockchain 2.0 is sort of the tokens, getting people to do stuff. And what we're working on now is something we call Ocean. And with Ocean, the goal is basically to create a universal data economy that incentivizes people for a data commons, as well as for supplying data for data marketplaces, right? So what Ocean is trying to do, it actually has its own objective function, right? And that is maximize the supply of high quality data for usage in AI and otherwise, right? So remember, Bitcoin, maximize security. Ocean, maximize the supply of high quality data. Whether or not it's priced, doesn't matter, right? So people can put a price on it, or they can make it free for the data commons. That's what Ocean is about. And then how do we do this? Well, we reward people for doing things to help this, of course. And if you think of when we say high quality, we have no idea if it's high quality or not. So we let the crowd decide via curation, a curation market. Think of a curation market as sort of a riff on prediction markets tuned towards basically putting your money where your mouth is on how valuable a data set is. That's kind of the summary. So we're rewarding people for curating data as well as for serving it up when it's made available, right? That's kind of the idea here. And you can cast this as an objective function, i.e. a block reward function, where the expected reward, which is the number of tokens given every interval, is proportional to the predicted popularity. So I have to predict how popular this thing by betting on it, staking on it in a prediction market setting. And then actual proofed popularity, how popular was it actually? How many times did it get served up in some sort of interval, right? So it's the predicted popularity bound together very tightly with the actual popularity and then scaled by the number of tokens that are given out in that interval. And this is what Ocean is doing, right? So you know, compare this to Bitcoin a couple slides ago. Bitcoin, it's trying to maximize security, where security is defined as hash rate. Ocean is trying to maximize the supply of high quality data by doing, and high quality via curation. So it's got a reward function related to that. And my point is, this is a wildly powerful way of thinking about things, because you can design the reward functions. Just like when you run an evolutionary algorithm, you're trying to figure out what's that objective function, or objective functions and constraints, right? And this is really the heart. The blockchain world doesn't, like, people in blockchain don't really get this because they don't normally have AI backgrounds and so on. But if you have a complex system background or AI background, then this is just dead obvious, or more obvious. So it's really quite powerful. Now, I'm going to generalize that and talk about, you know, some of the tools from the worlds of complex systems and how that's actually really useful for token design. And this is where a background in complex systems can be very valuable. And what I found in general, you know, a lot of people from the blockchain world, they come from economics, or maybe the crypto world, or maybe they're just young hackers and stuff. But there's very few people that are coming from the AI or complex systems world. And if you're coming from that world, it's kind of easier to get into blockchain because there's fewer things in the blockchain world that are developed. But if you come from the blockchain world and start to bring in AI or complex systems ideas, there's a much larger body of knowledge to incorporate, right? So my point is, if you want to do sort of complex systems with blockchain, it's much easier to approach it from the complex systems angle than the other side. So yeah, question.
I was just wondering, so one of the things also about Bitcoin, though, is that it's sort of the self-fulfilling prophecy, though, that because it has value, people want tokens.
Yeah.
And I'm curious how that then works in ocean. Like, just giving people tokens doesn't do stuff.
Yeah.
Unless those tokens are good for
something. Yeah, for sure. So In the world of, so two parts, I'll talk about, so there's this idea of securities versus utility tokens. So if I want, you know, if I have a stock in a company, that's a security, right? Or I have bonds or whatever, these are all securities. And, you know, there's a well-known meaning for that, and it's usually based on, for example, the predicted future revenues and cash flow of the company, right? And then you can sort of value that security. And you can tokenize that. You know, you can say, I'm going to put these tokens, these securities on a blockchain. But there's another sort of token, if you will, that you can value that's not based on sort of traditional notions, and that is utility tokens. And it's basically for the usage of these tokens within a network. And rather than valuing this as sort of like the way you would value a company, you actually have to value it the way you value an economy. And that's really what these blockchain ecosystems are about, is new economies. So within Bitcoin, there's sort of this new economy where there's Bitcoin tokens, and you know, it's maximizing how much people are using it. But of course, its main purpose is as a store of value, as a medium of exchange. And you know, if you think about money itself, it's just tokens or money or whatever only has value if there's a shared belief that it has value, right? So money is the ultimate network effect, if you will, right? So even like the U.S. dollar, right? It used to be backed by gold until Nixon took that away, and then it basically you just had to believe that it was worth something, and you know, the idea of money and stuff goes back, you know, thousands and thousands of years back to beads and giant rocks that and so on, right? But it's always been simply about a shared belief in the value of that thing, and it's no different with tokens. So now there are, you know, there's a shared belief in the value of Bitcoin, right? At first, no one knew how to value it. So the very first purchase was someone spent 10,000 bitcoins for a pizza in like 2010. And now it's, you know, $10,000 for one bitcoin. So times have changed, right? With Ethereum as well, with all of these, you know, they tend to have an exchange rate to US dollars and otherwise. And that's set by crypto exchanges. So it's sort of like a stock exchange, but for crypto, back and forth to other cryptocurrencies, as well as fiat, like US dollars. But the core point is, to your question then too, there is these, the value is in the utility for using this. So for Filecoin, which is a file storage network, that's kind of bound to the value of the tokens, of storage in a hard drive. With Ocean, the value is it's bound to the value of the data itself, as well as the ability to share it. And there's sort of the way that you can measure an economy, sort of the GDP, is this famous equation MV equals PQ, where on the left side, the M and V is the monetary value of each unit, which is the question mark, you don't know, and then the velocity of it, how many times per year is it used. And on the right side, the PQ is basically the actual utility, for example, the value of storing 1 gigabyte of storage, and then how many gigabytes does the network have. And on the right, then, it's sort of the measure of this economy. So overall, MV equals PQ. And this is just, you know, classic economics. And this is what people are starting to adopt for the blockchain world. Although, who knows, like, there's probably going to be better valuation models out there and so on. But this is a big question. So when people are doing ICOs, we try to measure on that. And, you know, even Ocean is going through its own you know, event for selling tokens and whatnot, and we went through this analysis, the MB equals PQ. Question?
And with fiat money, I mean, there's a great scene from Restaurant of the Universe where the dumb humans are seated on Earth and they decide to make everybody rich. They're just going to make leaves be the currency. So everybody grows on trees and look, more leaves you can bet, the richer you are.
Yeah.
You can't just make up a fiat money willy nilly.
Yeah.
And that's what causes inflation.
Yeah.
So I'm going to destroy the Yuan dynasty in China.
Yeah.
Which is a way of saying that I don't accept your instrumental question.
Yeah. Great. No, thank you for pushing back, right? A key part of maintaining the value is scarcity, of course, right? And so if you just print money willy-nilly, whether it's bitcoins or US dollars, then you will have hyperinflation, right? Like we saw in Germany, for example, right? And elsewhere, lots of, you know, we're seeing in South America. So Bitcoin, you know, if you think about the US system, the feds, you know, they decide to print money willy-nilly whenever they want, but they, you know, there's sort of some semblance of control, right? If they print it too crazy, then the US dollar will crash and that will, you know, wreck the world, the US economy, maybe the world economy, whatever. So they try not to do that, although if they wanted, they could. And with tokens, basically, there is an algorithmic schedule for releasing, so it's not some opaque decision that's made with, you know, a room filled with cigar-smoking bankers. Instead, it's just a very specific algorithm, right? Which is this here, this mining reward, right? So it's a very, very fixed schedule over time. But at the core, there's scarcity. So there's only going to ever be 21 million bitcoins ever printed, right? We know what that is, And yeah, the scarcity is the key part. Otherwise, you're going to have hyperinflation. Does that make sense? Okay. Yeah. Well, that could be very valuable, just like, you know, the Mona Lisa, right? People don't even know how to value that, or any art piece, right? And that's non-fungible assets, right? But for fungible assets, you actually want, you know, which are basically, you can trade one for the other, right? You can trade one gold bar for another gold bar, one US dollar for another. You want enough liquidity where you can exchange these, right? So with Bitcoin, there's 21 million Bitcoins, and each Bitcoin itself is actually divisible 100 million times. You know, there are 100 million Satoshis in one Bitcoin. And so there's enough divisibility that you can have many, many, many owners so that you can have this economy that emerges, right? I'll keep going here, but let's talk offline, sure. In complex systems, I'll just give a couple examples where some complex systems background is super useful for token design. One of them is the subfield of complex systems and AI is evolutionary algorithms, where I spend a lot of time. And so there's actually a really, really cool parallels that I realized between tokenized ecosystems, like public blockchains, Bitcoin, Ocean, whatever, and evolutionary algorithms. So first of all, they each have a goal, right? In tokenized ecosystem, this is the block reward function, like maximize hash rate. And in evolutionary algorithms, this is the fitness function or objective function, right? Like minimize error in training a neural network, right? And then you need some way of measuring this or testing it, right? And in the case of blockchains, it's some sort of proof, right? So Bitcoin has proof of work. You prove that you are hashing because if you're successful at finding this solution of this puzzle, then you find this nonce and you get your bitcoins, right? So there's different sorts of proofs. In Ocean, the proof is you have to prove that you served the data up to someone else, right? And it can be a deterministic proof. It can be stochastic. It can be interactive. There's lots of ways, right? And there's a whole subfield of computation around verifiable computation there, right? And then in evolutionary algorithms, you have evaluating the fitness, like simulating a circuit, right? Or running some robot around and seeing how far it ran, right? Or whatever it is. And basically, this is sort of the inner loop of that optimization, right? The next thing is system agents, you know? So in a tokenized ecosystem, you've got miners running around, and they're all trying to basically contribute to the hash rate, right? They're trying to basically stick around, and they're in this network and contribute, and they're looking for block rewards somehow to survive, to keep going. In evolutionary algorithms, you've got individuals, or more generally, agents in a population, right? And they're just kind of running around and doing their thing. there's sort of a system clock in both cases. You've got a block reward. In the case of Bitcoin, it's every 10 minutes. It can also be continuous. In evolutionary algorithms, you have a generation, right? But of course, you can have steady state evolutionary algorithms too. So there's basically chunked or continuous systems. And then incentives and disincentives. So in the case of blockchain ecosystems, you can't really control what humans are doing. They're running around doing whatever. All you can do is reward them when they present a solution to your puzzle, when they give that proof. And the other thing you can do, actually, in some systems, when you've got proof of stake, you can actually steal their stake. So it's carrot and stick. The carrot is block rewards, and the stake is, if they act badly, take their stake, slash their stake, right? Same thing in evolutionary algorithms. At the end of the day, right, all you really need is to kill off a few of the worst individuals, and you have convergence, right? So you can reward by reproducing, and you can punish by killing them, right? There's other things you can do too, but at the end of the day, it's survival of the fittest, right? So there are very, very strong interactions here, back and forth. And it kind of makes sense because, as I'll get to later, you know, when you start thinking about blockchains, public blockchains, as life forms, et cetera, then it all starts to make a lot more sense, right? And you can generalize all of this to basically anti-fragile systems, right?
You could have replaced evolutionary algorithm with just evolution, right?
Yeah, that's like a great point, actually, yeah. In fact, I think I had a table like that briefly, but yeah, it's a very good point. And this is where all of this ties together. But it's fascinating because now we actually can design these systems and actually deploy them to the real world and measure them and so on, right? And I think that's what, that's actually what my next system slide here is about. So when there's sort of design at two levels. There's the design of, you know, each proof itself, each sort of system. And then sort of the meta part, right? So, but quick background, you know, I spent a lot of time working in the field of software for designing computer chips, right? CAD, computer aided design. And, you know, we have these computer chips that have like a billion transistors. And there's no way that a single team of 20 or 50 engineers can design a chip with a billion transistors. It's just too complicated. What do? They use CAD tools, but then those CAD tools themselves simulate, right? And that's what makes it possible for a team of 10 or 50 engineers to design a massively complicated circuit in, you know, a month or 3 months or 6 months, right? So simulators and CAD tools are absolutely essential. But then how are we currently designing tokenized ecosystems? By the seat of our pants. I'm not kidding. We have no tools hardly at all, right? We have, you know, a bit of theory, the stuff I talked about a bit. But it's like, oh my god, we have really nothing. And we might be getting it all wrong, right? You know, some people are trying to design in governance systems, but is that too overbearing? Or Bitcoin, it's sort of governance to upgrade the protocol. All they do is hard forks. Is that enough? The hard fork of basically, you kind of create your own version and let people run that network and see what happens, right? But we could be completely screwing this up. And so, you know, what I see that we desperately need is two things. We need simulators, which actually could be agent-based systems, right? I know there's a lot, you know, in this community, there's a lot of work in the complex systems community, and probably several of you guys have, you know, done a lot of work on this. That could be incredibly valuable here, right? And then one level above, once you have an agent-based system to simulate what might happen in this network, CAD tools around that to figure out what are the parameters that had the biggest impact, and then how can we, you know, look at the interactions among the various parameters to tune and have better systems overall that give us the dynamics that we want, right? And, you know, sort of reason number 37 why you might care. There is tons of money at stake, right? And like I said, we might be getting it all wrong, right? So this is a snapshot from a coin market cap half a day ago, just to give you a feel, right? So the Bitcoin ecosystem itself is 170 billion, Ethereum 100 billion, Ripple 43 billion, Bitcoin Cash 24 billion. And any given week, 30 or 40 of these ecosystems are each worth more than $1 billion, right? Question?
Yeah. And I mean, or do we just accept
accept that, oh, well, it's out there, it's now part of this ecosystem, our ecosystem,
yeah.
Even though it's this vicious thing creating bad behavior.
Yeah, so, well, you know, a broad statement is technology is almost always a double-edged sword, especially the really powerful ones, right? You know, go back to Nobel, all that. In this case, if there's, you know, you can define a community around an ecosystem as the people who hold those tokens, or maybe the miners. And if you can convince the majority of miners to maybe upgrade the protocol to do something, then you can fix things. And it really depends if you can convince that community of miners, right? So in the case of Ethereum, for example, a year and a half ago, there was this thing called the DAO. And it raised $150 million, which back then was a huge amount. These days, not so much, you know, compared to like Telegram just raised more than $1 billion for their ICO. But a year and a half ago, this was massive. And then someone hacked it. Some hacker came along and stole about $70 million. And this was a big chunk of the Ethereum ecosystem at the time. So the Ethereum community kind of like had a hard look at themselves and asked, should we try to roll this back, right? And so they proposed a hard fork where basically someone made a change to the code that removed all the hackers' transactions. Not the transaction, sorry, just ignored the code itself was changed such that the transactions would be ignored by that public key. And then they tried to convince the community to the miners to adopt this new code that's running, which is a riff of the previous code, and hoping that the majority of miners would accept it, right? And it turns out that the majority did accept it. So Ethereum hard forked into this new version of Ethereum that was running that, in this case, fixed this one problem, this hack. You know, since then, there have been other hacks of 10 million, 50 million, and more. But now that Ethereum is much bigger, they didn't bother changing that. And of course, but there was actually a sub-community that was really annoyed by this. They're like, what? Ethereum is supposed to be immutable. The code that's running is supposed to be unstoppable, right? And so, therefore, there was, whatever the code is lost. So even if there was a bug in there that let the hacker do this, that was the intent, right? And so they were taking Larry Lessig literally, right? Code is law. And so there was this community that is like, code is law, man. And so they kept the old version of Ethereum running, and that's what's called Ethereum Classic. And it's not in the top 10. It has been before, but it's in the top 20. And it's worth a few billion, actually, right? So there's these hardcore people saying, you know, unstoppable code, man, right? Now in the future, but towards, you know, you could have nefarious governments or organizations that are doing more evil things. And for example, you could have a market around hits. And it could make a lot of money, right? Because it's actually a bounty system for killing people, right? And there's going to be other people that run miners and stuff because they could make money on that. And that's terrible. And a lot of people are seeing that this will probably happen in the next couple of 3 years, right? And then governments are going to try to shut down. And it's going to be really hard, right? And so governments in general have, you know, tried to ban Bitcoin here and there. And it's not going to work. And, you know, Bitcoin is going to keep going unless there's like, it gets shut down everywhere in the world, right? But there's always going to be some random guy or girl in some corner of the universe that's running his Bitcoin node or her Bitcoin node and like clutching on that till they're, you know, dead, right? And really, for all practical purposes, it's kind of unkillable. But you never know. I mean, there are some altcoins out there that got released that no one really cares about, right? You know, some, you know, fork of, say, Dogecoin, which is some joke coin, right? And no one really cares, so there's just dead systems out there, right? But the popular ones, the big ones, they really are hard to stop, right? And the more you kick them, the stronger they get, right? You know, if someone actually hacks the system and maybe makes $10 million or $50 million, you know what happens? People go in, improve the protocol, and then there's a hard fork that people go with, and so that hack no longer happens. So every sort of public blockchain is like a massive bounty system for bugs, right? So instead of just rewarding people with 10 grand or 20 grand for finding bugs, you're rewarding them with 10 million or 20 million, right? And this has happened, so it's actually quite remarkable. So I'm going to keep going. Is it okay if I run a bit over, or how much time do we have? Okay. I'll try to move a bit faster, though, for this last bit, because I'm about probably halfway through. So benevolent computer viruses, aka smart contracts, the next part. So what if you use a blockchain, like a database, to store state of a state machine, right? And if you think about even like a CPU, right? A CPU has a register, and it's having these updates of state based on some circuits that are changing the register values, right? And then the stack, et cetera. So if you're doing that to store state of a state machine, then you actually are getting decentralized processing. So rather than just a database like MongoDB decentralized, you're getting decentralized processing, like EC2 decentralized or something like that, right? And once you have decentralized processing combined with decentralized storage, then you can actually get a world computer, right? This sort of public utility computer that's out there. And that's basically the vision of Ethereum, right? You've got processing, you've got storage, and you've got communications, right? Like messaging back and forth, et cetera. And that's kind of the vision of Ethereum. And Ethereum is, it was first conceived in 2013, and late 2013, and probably got built over the subsequent year and a half, and now has become the number two cryptocurrency. But it's not really, it's selling it short to just call it a cryptocurrency. It's really, a world computer, and really sort of decentralized processing. And smart contracts themselves are super interesting for many reasons. You can run code, so just like Amazon released something called Lambda a couple years ago, where you kind of have, they call it serverless architecture, but you basically have a function or some script that you just put onto Amazon. You don't have to run your own servers, and it just goes, right? But what if you can actually create a script where there's not even any Amazon below, right? And it just runs, it's just out there. And you can kind of think of it like this as computer viruses, right? I can put a computer virus out there, and it's kind of just running around. You're not hosting it, and it just makes copy of itself. But most viruses are, not benevolent, right? They're kind of doing wonky, weird, bad things. But imagine you have a computer virus that's running out there, doing whatever you have programmed it to do. It's not bound to any given machine or anything. It's just on this more generalized compute substrate. It's running autonomously. It's on the decentralized infrastructure. And it can actually manipulate resources. It's got its own wallet, right? So it's got Ether, which is the tokens for Ethereum. It's got its own wallet, and it can spend them and get them back too, right? So you basically have code that can own stuff, right? Self-owning code. You can also think of it as good computer viruses, right? But that to me is like kind of amazing on its own, right? And they call these things decentralized autonomous organizations, right? DAOs, right? And what's cool, you can actually take one step further, right? So what if this code that's running isn't just some simple script, but it's got some agent-like behavior, right? And an agent in, the complex systems way of thinking, as a feedback control system, right? Where it has a model of the world, and it's actuating against the world, seeing what the results are, updating its model of the world, and keeping it iterating, right? So the inputs, the outputs, and so on. That's really what an AI DAO is. So you've got this feedback control system in software running on decentralized infrastructure, right? So it's very different than just running around in like some blocks world or something. It's actually on this public utility. So you can view an AI DAO as an AI, an AGI especially, running on decentralized processing substrate, or equivalently, a DAO running with AI algorithms, right? So I'm going to give an example of this. It's a very simple one, but it's buildable tomorrow. You can imagine the following. You run an AI art engine to generate a new image, right? Use genetic programming, deep learning, whatever. So by the way, the smart contract does this, the DAO. So it generates this art image, and then it claims copyright. Why not have some legals in there? It doesn't need to. It creates multiple editions. So it can say, okay, there's 10 limited editions of this thing. And you can do that too. Then it posts those for sale. So it puts them onto Getty images, or maybe a decentralized marketplace like Getty, something like Open Bazaar. And then it sells those, right? So maybe it took $1 of compute power to generate this. And then it sells each of those for $1, but it's got 10 of them. Or maybe it has just one and it sells it for 10 bucks, right? So $1 of compute power in, it makes 10 bucks. What does it do then? It takes that 10 bucks, creates 10 new images, and then sells those, makes 100 bucks. Creates 100 new images, sell those, makes 1,000. It keeps going. And over time, it's going to accumulate wealth, right? $10 to 100, 1,000. Maybe we'll end up with the world's first AI millionaire, right? Running completely autonomously, right? And this is actually possible with today's technology. It's kind of amazing, right? there's actually quite a few different architectures you can put around AI DAOs. So one of them is you can have the AI running the very center. So sort of the central smart contract that's just running, you know, as one sort of DAO out there. And then you can have token holders for this AI DAO on the outside, right? Trying to which are people, right? The next thing you can do is you could have a very dumb central contract that's just sort of, say, like a clearinghouse. And then agents, like external entities, can vote on it. And with the DAO, the external agents voting on it were people, right? But what if instead of people voting on it, you can have AIs, right? So the thing that's running on the blockchain is super dumb. But then you have 100 or 10,000 agents out there that are AI agents controlling this thing, right? Go ahead.
How critical is all of the security features of the blockchain to the success of your scenario just now?
These ones that I just described, it's designable in a way where security won't be an issue,
right?
Yeah. So. Like, remember, you know, the core crypto in blockchains is stuff that goes back to the 60s and 70s, right? Like, you know, you've got SHA-256 hashing, and the SHA-3 algorithm, which is, you know, basically uncrackable for practical purposes, right? You know, maybe NSA already has their quantum computer, we'll see. But and by the way, too, you know, quantum, you know, whether it comes on online in 10 years, 15 years, you know, that's sort of the timeline. There are emerging algorithms for quantum-tolerant crypto as well. So most blockchains don't have that because it's too compute-intensive, but that's also not an issue in the longer term. So
there's some issues that are embedded here that I'm not sure Ethereum can solve. You have a futures contract and you have distributed computing, you have to agree on what the time is, right? Like, you have to have your distributed node say, okay, well, this person loses on the futures contract because the other node that's going to confirm this in a different branch has to also believe in the time. And in these kinds of interactions, you might be subject to arbitrage with these kinds of programs unless you're playing some sort of stochastic strategy, for example.
Yeah.
Like, it maybe I'm not saying that there's not useful things to do, but there certainly seems to be a huge class of things you can't do on the Ethereum platform.
Yeah, so a few things, right? So notion of clock to start with. Blockchains themselves don't really care about wall clock time. They use logical clock, right, which is essentially the length of the hash chain. It's like Lamport clock going back to the early 80s, right? So basically, how many